Let's look at this numerical, which helps us in doing the profit margin for a unit linked endowment assurance contract, right? So let's try to make the details regarding the whole, and after that we'll start developing the table. A life insurance company issues a 4-year unit linked endowment assurance. So, okay, the term period is 4 years. Then the type of the policy is endowment assurance policy. And the life is male. Age of the male is 40 years exact. Level premiums of 1,000 per annum are payable in advance. So premium is 1,000 per annum. First year, 50% of the premium is allocated to units. Allocation in the first year is only 50%, whereas in the 102.5% in the second, third, and fourth years. So allocation in the other years, right? When I look at allocation, other years, it is around 102.5%. Fine. Then we are also being informed that in this numerical, the units are subject to bid offer spread of 5%. Okay, BO spread is going to be 5%. And management charge, annual management charge is 0.5% of the bid value of the units is deducted every year. 0.5% of the bid value of the units. Fine. If the policyholder dies during the terms of the policy, the death benefit of 4,000 or the bid value of the units after the deduction of the management charge, whichever is higher, is payable at the end of the year of death. So death benefit is either 4,000 or the bid value, whichever is bid value minus the management charge, whichever is higher. On surrender or on survival to the end of the term, the bid value of the units payable at the end of the year of exit. So surrender is also there. The company uses the following assumptions in the profit testing: rate of growth on the assets in the unit fund. Growth of the unit fund, it is taking as 6%, whereas the growth with respect to non-unit fund, it is taking as 4%. Fair enough. Independent rate of mortality, it is taking as AM92 select. So I'll go along with that. And withdrawal rates are 10%. So withdrawal, again, in the first year, I'll take it as 10%. And withdrawals other years, I'm taking them as 5% every year. Initial expense is 150 plus 100% of 150 plus 100% of the amount of initial commission. So initial expenses, it is 150 and 100% of the amount of initial commission. So this is 150, not in percentage terms, it is just dollars. All right, renewal expenses of 50. I'm having a renewal expense of 50 along on the second and subsequent premium dates. Initial commission of 10% of the first premium. Right, initial commission is 10% of the first premium. Renewal commission 2.5% of the second and the subsequent year's premium. And the risk discount rate, we are taking as 8%. Fine. Calculate the profit margin on the assumption that the office does not zeroize. So there are two steps. Under the assumption that the office does not zeroize the future negative cash flows and the decrements are uniformly distributed year over year. And suppose the office zeroize the future negative cash flows, calculate the expected provisions that must be set up at the end of each year per policy in force at the start of the each year. And after that, compute the profit margin. So these are, so one without zeroization, I want to compute the profit margin. One after the possible zeroization, I want to compute the profit margin. All right. So a few things that we can work out to start with. Right, if you look at the initial expense, we said 150 plus 100% of the amount of the initial commission. So it is nothing but 10% of the first premium. First premium is 1000. So 10%. Of the first premium. First premium is 100. Right? First premium is 1000. So 10% of the first premium, which is 100. And it is said 100% of the amount of initial commission, which is again 100. So initial expense totally I can say it is 150 plus 100% of, right, 100% of whatever is the initial commission, which is 10% times the first premium amount. So which is working out to around 250. If I am looking at the initial expense, it is 250. Whereas the renewal expense, it is saying renewal commission is 2.5%. So here the initial commission is 100. So overall, the initial expense is coming out to be 250, whereas in case of renewal commission, the renewal commission is 2.5% of the second and subsequent year's premium. So it is 2.5% of the premium, 1000. So around 25 is the renewal commission. Right, renewal commission, I'll get it as this much. Whereas initial commission, I'm getting the initial commission as 10% of the premium. Initial commission is 100. So if I'm talking of initial expense, it is 250 plus overall also, I mean, if I'm including initial expense plus initial commission, it is going to be 250 plus 100, which is 350. Renewal commission plus renewal expense, if I am taking, renewal expense is 25, renewal expense is 50, renewal commission is 25, resulting in 75 being your yearly cost. Now, on the other side, I would also try looking out, making a multiple decrement table for 4 years. Now that we are having a lives whose ages are, it is issued to a person whose age is 40. So I, for a 4 year period, I'm taking it as 40, 41, 42, 43. Then I'll look at QX with respect to D, the death. For which I'll take AM92 select tables with an interest rate assumption of 4%. AM92 tables, where I'll look at Q40 select for each of the periods. So for 40, I'll take it as 0.000788. This is the number that is there. But for 41, I'll take it as Q40+1. So making it 0.000962. And from the next year onwards, I'm taking it normal Q42 itself, which is 0.001104. And Q43, I'll take it as 0.001208, taking directly from the AM92 tables. And I know QX with respect to surrender. We said 10% of the policies are getting surrendered in the first year, right? I can take it as 10% in the first year, but it is equal to 5% in each of the subsequent years. So in all the years, I'm taking it as 5% like this. Now that I have independently, these have been the rates, I'll take the dependence, which means I'll take AQX. I'll take AQX, one with respect to death, and I'll also compute AQX with respect to surrender. Both of them, I should be able to find out. So we know the formula. First of all, the relationship between AQX and QX, we say that AQX with the decrement alpha, we simply say it as QX with the decrement alpha time 1 minus half QX with the decrement beta. Now the same logic I'll use here, right? QX alpha. So this is the QX for death. If I want, I'm taking it as QX of death into 1 minus of 0.5 times QX of beta. So this is giving me AQX with respect to death. Okay, I'm computing AQX with respect to death. These are the numbers. Similarly, I can find AQX with respect to X, which is QXS, multiplied by 1 minus half QXD. This is giving me 0.09961, and finally it has gone to this extent. So based on this, now that I have these as AQXD and AQXS, I can very well find out APX. For each of them, I have the AQX. Right, I have the AQXD, so APX for me is nothing but 1 minus of these two things. 1 minus of these two things, which is across giving me these as the numbers. So based on this, I can look at right from the beginning of the period, right, proportions with respect to beginning of the period. If I'm looking at, okay, for the first period, if I'm talking of 1, then for the second period, it is nothing but 1 times this percentage, which is giving me 0.89. And similarly, when I go to the next year, it becomes 0.8535. And the next year it is going, which means 80% of the policies which were there at the beginning of the 40 years, by the end of 43 years, it's only 80% of the policies that would be existing, because the remaining 20% of them would be leaving either because of death, would be leaving the population either because of death or because of the surrender part. Right? So this is one thing that we are talking of. So this table also will help us in doing the required computations. And on the other side, now we will move on towards the unit fund. We'll get ahead into the calculation of the unit fund. We'll look at it in terms of year 1. Probably I'll call it Y1, Y2, Y3, Y4. Over the 4-year period, we are looking at the fund. Okay, units at the beginning of the year. initially there were no units, right? Initially there were no units. So there is an allocation now. Once at the beginning there were no units, there is an allocation that has, right, the amount allocation, there is 50% in the first year. So 50% of the premium is allocated in the first year, whereas in the second, from the second year onwards, it is 102% of the premium. Okay, this is where 102% of the premium is allocated. All right, so this is the allocation part. Now we know that the bid offer spread, the bid offer spread is around 5%. So I'll take the bid offer spread as 5% of the allocation amount. This is going as the bid offer spread, 5% of 5% of the allocated amount. 51.25, then I am talking about 5% of, which is 51.25 again, and even in the last year, the bid offer spread is going to be this much. But what about here? It is 500 times the bid offer spread of 5%, which is 25. Now, we are talking about out of the allocated amount after deduction of 25. So the balance in each of the periods, right? I'm talking about, I'm taking off the balance in the first year, this which amount is going to be invested. So this invested amount, we switching, right? This invested amount is fetching an interest. This 475 is fetching an interest of 6%, which is giving around 50, probably let me calculate the interest separately. So this 475, I just compute the interest separately, and I also look at the management charge, right? The management charge is typically computed, okay, the fund value before management charge, which is coming out to this number plus this. On the top of it, there is a management charge that is applied, which is on the fund value, there is a 0.5% is coming out, which is working out to 2.517. So fund value after the management charge is going to be this number minus this number. So this is what is the situation at the end of the first year. Now this is going to be the beginning period for the second year. Now this much got allocated, which means in the second year, now the same logic I can put for each of the years to repeat the process. Now the balance that I'm looking at, there are some units that are there in the first year, something got allocated. Out of that, the bid offer spread has taken out remaining. So overall, this much is the balance that is there. On that balance, I see an interest. On that balance, I see an interest of 6% is being levied. Right? On that balance, an interest of 6% is levied, which is taking me this much. The same logic, I can take it across. Even here, I'll take it across. Right, whatever is the balance. Then we are talking about the fund value before. Even these, I am repeating the formula as it is. On this, there is a management charge of 0.5%. So this is the management charge, and fund value after the management charge is going to be this much. and I'm going to repeat this for the others as well. And now what I could see is, okay, here the management charge is, okay, here also I have to compute the management charge. On this, I'm talking about a management charge of 0.5%. Similarly, on this, I'm computing a management charge of 0.5%. So overall, at the end of the 4 years, the fund value is getting accumulated to 3840.421. Up to here, there is no issue in terms of understanding this numerical, because this is the unit fund part. Then I am looking at the non-unit fund part, right? This is the unit fund. So I'll talk about the non-unit fund, which actually belongs to the insurance company. Okay, let me talk about the unallocated premiums first of all. The first input into the non-unit. Okay, here it is the remaining 50%. Right, so I'll call this as 1 minus of 50% times the premium amount. So it's around 500. Whereas from the second year onwards, it is 1 minus of 102.5% times 1000, which is giving me minus 25 is the allocated premium, unallocated premium in each of the three. Now the bid offer spread, which has been charged, is typically belonging to the insurance company. So this is an additional amount which the insurance company has got. And we have also talked about the expenses for each of the years. In the first year, we said the expense is 350, but from the next year onwards, the overall expense is going to be 75. So these have contributed to the expenses. Now, on the top of this, whatever is the balance at this moment, this would be invested. So which means the unallocated premium plus the bid offer spread minus the expenses. So 175 is the balance here, whereas this balance has become minus 48.75 here. Now this amount is interest invested. So this 175 invested, which is going to fetch 4%, is giving some 7 bucks. Whereas in all the other 3 years, it was a negative expense of minus 1.95. And even there is one more income which was earned, which is the management charge, which is this positive number. So the overall, if I am looking at now, I am looking at the death benefit part, right? If at all I am looking at the death benefit part, where there is an additional amount. See, in case of surrender benefit, it's just that fund value that is being paid. So it's not going to cost anything for the insurance company. But in case of death benefit, there is a guaranteed amount of 4,000 bucks. So there is a minimum of 4,000 that is getting paid. So the fund value is only 500, right? The fund value is only 500, which means there is an excess death benefit that it has to pay. So which is coming out as 4,000 minus whatever is the fund value at the end of the first year. That I'm multiplying it with whatever is the probability of death in the first year. This is the probability of death. So if I look at the death benefit here, there is a 4,000 minimum that needs to be paid, but the fund value is only 500. So that is an extra cost from the insurance company's perspective. This has to be multiplied by the probability of death. So which is taking that this is the additional cost for the insurance company in the first, if the deaths happen in the first year. Similarly, if the deaths happen in the second, it is 4000 minus this, because the this much of amount is there as a fund value. So the balance has to be borne by the insurance company, and this multiplied by the probability of death in the second year, which is going to be this much. The same logic, if I repeat, 4000 minus this is the value of the units, and I am multiplying by the same probability of death in the third year. And finally, in the last case also, 4000 minus 3840, if I am multiplying it with the probability of death in the final year. So these are the numbers that are looking like, which means I could cash flows at the end of the year if I have to compute. Yes, this is the balance that is there. This balance has paid this much interest. Along with that, they have got the management charge, right? This management charge is going to come at the end of the year only, but these are all coming at the beginning of the year. Along with that, the death benefit, they may have to pay 2.61. So overall, the cash flow is coming out to 181.9 in the first year. And if I am taking it across, it is minus 45, minus 38 and minus 31 in each of these years. And now, if I am looking at the probability of in-force policies, right, I can very well take the probability of the in-force policies. I can take directly from here. So I will take the probability of in-force policies from this location, which will give me that these are the numbers of the probabilities of the in-force policies. And from here, I could very comfortably come out with the expected value, because, okay, this is the amount that is required in each of the periods. So if required, I'll also do a discounting part. Right, probability of in-force policies. These are the policies that are present at the beginning of each of the years. And if I am taking the number, so I'll also take the discounting factor based on the risk-based discounting rate. So I'll do it as 1 by 1.08 to the power, or this I'll put it as 1 by 1.08, and probably all these I take this number divided by 1.08. So for the previous next year, the discounting factor is going to be this and all. Now this is what helps me in terms of computing the expected present value, which I would simply do it as sum product of this, comma this, comma this. So which is giving me that the expected present value is going to be around 88.54. Right, the expected present value of the profit is directly coming out to 88.54. And similarly, if I want to find out the expected present value of the premiums, I can very well find out, because I can multiply the premiums which are received. 1000 is being received in each of the periods. So I could very well take the summation of these 3 plus 1. So it comes out as 1 plus the summation of these 3. I multiply this entire thing by 1000, because this is what is the summation of all the present values. So 3, 5. Now the premiums are being received at the beginning of each of the periods. Right, the premiums are received at the beginning of each of the periods. So let me see if, okay, here the premium is 1000, but here If I'm talking about the premium, yes, only this many policies are in force. So the expected present value here comes out as the probability of in force policies multiplied by the discount factor multiplied by 1000. Okay, here the discounting factor I'll take it for 1 year, not for 2 years, because it is received at the beginning of the period. So the discount factor is this much. So here 85% of the policies are in force. You are receiving the premium at the end of 2 years or the beginning of the 3rd year. So the premium that you are receiving is only this much. And for the final year, again, you have your 1000, but only 80% of the policies are in force, and I discounted by 3 years, resulting in 642. Which means, if I really want to find out the expected present value of the premiums, it is only 3207, which is also telling me that the profit margin in this case is directly working out to, the profit margin in this case is working out to 88 divided by 3200, resulting in a 2.76%. Right? So this is what is the overall workout. But now if I'm looking at the cash flows, right in the second, third, 4th years, there is a negative cash flow that is getting generated. This is the profit margin without the zeroization. But we are saying there is a possibility of zeroization, which means I will not maintain the negative cash flows in each of these years. I'll try to maintain up a zero cash flow in each of the years. This is where I'll try to do the zeroisation. And for that, okay, I'll start from the last year where the negative cash flows are there. So what I'm saying is, at the end of the 3rd year, right, at the end of the 3rd year, see, in the 4th year, at the end of the 4th year, I require this much of, this is a shortage. Which means I require 31.59 as the cash flow at the end of the 3rd year, at the end of the 4th year, which means at the end of the 3rd year, I have to maintain at least this much. So what it says is, okay, we'll talk about the reserves here. At the end of the 3rd year, I require at least this number, 31.59 divided by 1.04. At least this will give me something sufficient for the 4th year. So if I have at least 30.39 in the final year, in the at the end of the 3rd year, I would invest it for 1.04. I would invest it at 4%, and I would make this cash flow as zero. But here also I have minus 38, which means I require 38.73 for this year as well. Which means in the previous year, how much I require minus of this, which is 38.03, plus this. This will fetch me another 1 point at the rate of 4% for next year. But in this year, I require at least this much. So 66 point, this 66.44, if I am not considering any of the death related benefits. But here, if I consider the death related, so which means whatever 38.73, along with I also require this 30.37, right? 38.73 plus this 30.37. I'll look at only for those guys who are alive at 42. I'll not consider everyone here. Those guys who are alive at 42, which means I'll consider only this much proportion of them. So, which means the overall reserve requirement for me is 64.95 here. The same logic if I am taking it here, even here there is a negative of 45. So 45 is required for the second year, 64.95 is required for the third and the fourth years put together. Now the same logic if I am taking, I need 45.18. Out of this 64.95, I'll look at only that proportion that would be alive at 45. So all this I'm discounting it by 4%, which is giving me that my reserve requirement at the end of the first year or at the end of the first year is going to be 102 point something, which means if I am looking at the values associated with at the beginning, these are the values at the end of the years. So I would even consider at the beginning of the year for each by multiplying them with their corresponding probabilities of survival. So this will give me 28.82. This, if I am multiplying it with the corresponding probability of survival, this is giving me 61.64. This number multiplying with the probability of survival is giving me 92.37. So which means now the updated cash flows for me, the updated cash flows right now are coming out to 180. The beginning of the first year, it is nothing but 181.9 minus 92. So 89 is coming in the first, and all the three periods it is coming out to zeros. Now using this, if I want to find out the expected cash flows using the same logic, I'll do a sum product again, but with these cash flows, with this being the probability of in force and with this being the discount factor, which will turn around to 82.89. So from here, if I am looking at the profit margin, it is slightly reduced. 82.89 divided by the expected present value of the premiums, working out to 2.58%. In the earlier situation, it was around 2.76%, but now it has gone to 2.58%, which is a very clear indication that if the zeroisation is being done, the profit realization is actually getting delayed, which is very, very clearly resulting in reduction in your overall profit margin. All right. So a step-by-step workout will definitely provide us the mechanism of computing the profit margin for any kind of a policy with or without zeroisations. All right. So these are the steps which are common for any kind of a policy, especially unit-linked policies. You just need to be very comfortable in terms of working out a step-by-step process for the same. All right.